Thanks for joining us for Ruth Institute's podcast. Our website is www.ruthinstitute.org. We seek to change the narrative around marriage and family to create a cultural climate favorable to lifelong married love. We also seek to promote recovery and healing from the wounds of the sexual revolution and share our stories with the next generation. I encourage you to visit our website, where you can sign up for our free e-newsletter and receive more information on what we're doing around the country and how you can be involved. Dr. J is once again Molly Smith's guest on From the Median. They're discussing her latest book, 101 Tips for Marrying the Right Person, and Interrelatedness of the Marriage and Life Issues.
Our guest this evening is someone who has devoted much of her adult life to God's work and to His Word. Dr. Jennifer Roback Morse is the founder and president of the Ruth Institute and is a returning guest to the program. And she is here tonight to talk with us about a variety of issues relating to life and the family, but especially about how we, the people, strengthen and grow in our faith and in our marriages, in our family relationships, in a way that honors God. And there's nobody that can do this better than Dr. Jennifer Roback Morse. We will be talking about some of the tools that Jennifer and her organization have provided for us to do just this exact thing. Her organization is committed to achieving the goals of the Christian pro-life, pro-family movement and to grow this movement to a point that everyone in the nation has had a chance to hear the wisdom of Christ's teaching and to either accept it or to reject this wisdom. So without further ado, welcome to the program, Jennifer.
Oh, thanks so much for having me on, Molly. It's always a pleasure.
You know, before we get into the discussion, I want to read a short paragraph to the listeners, and this is what it says, and it's straight off of Jennifer Roback Morse's front page of her website, which is ruthinstitute.org. It says, "Dear friends, the sexual revolution has been going on for my entire lifetime. Millions of people have been harmed by its empty promises. At the Ruth Institute, and especially at the Ruth Refuge, we are healing the world, one broken heart at a time. And we invite you to be part of our mission. Whether you are a child of divorce, a donor-conceived person, or a refugee from the hookup culture, the Ruth Institute is here for you. You will find friendly virtual faces, listening ears, and powerful information. I invite you to join us with an open heart filled with the hope for a better life for yourself and others. The suffering from the sexual revolution has gone on long enough. Are you with me? Let's begin. Your friend, Dr. Jennifer Roback Morse." I love that intro on your website, Jennifer, and I think it sets the tone for what we want to talk about tonight, because it is such a hopeful message there. We are living in a culture that is filled with sort of, you know, at times we see rage, we see, you know, ill humor, we see brokenness. But when I go to your website, I do see hope there. My first question to you is, how successful do you think you are being in reaching these broken hearts?
Oh, well, that's a good question, Molly. first of all, thank you for reading that, and I appreciate it very much indeed. I think when I am actually in front of people and people are actually reading my material or hearing me speak, I think I'm very successful. The problem that we have at the Ruth Institute is getting a big enough platform and a big enough microphone so that more and more people can hear about it, because I know for a fact that when I'm in the room with people, they are moved with what I have to say. We recently had a half-day retreat here in Lake Charles, Louisiana, and I know that it had a very positive impact on the people who attended.
So how do we get this out? I mean, we're doing our best here, and I've just read a letter that I've just recently received from a listener saying that the work that we do on our program is pretty well groundbreaking, because we cover people like you who they've never heard before. And I think this is the new media. This is the new medium. It's getting to people like you and being able to give you a platform to talk about. So tonight we're trying to do exactly that. And every time we have you, and I encourage you, Jennifer, we've just recently updated our website. Your interview right now is available for people on podcasts. So if you want to post that to your website and to your you know, people that you've, before it's been very difficult to get to our programs, but now it is very easy. It can go up in a podcast. So we are going to be pushing it out via Facebook and, you know, on our websites, et cetera, you know, all of these interviews. So hopefully we'll do our little bit to get the message out there for you and to get people to gravitate towards Ruth Institute. Again, ruthinstitute.org is the name of the organization, and that's the name of the website. Jennifer, if, when you do get to people, what are, and I guess this is something that I want to talk about, what are some of the stories you are hearing without divulging any confidences or, you know, why did you set yourself up? What are the stories you're hearing from people?
Oh, my goodness, Molly, you can't, it's all over the map. I mean, one of the things that will happen in a talk, actually, when I'm in front of an audience, is that people will come up to me afterwards and say, you're the first adult I have ever heard say that divorce is hard on children. Oh, I hear that all the time.
Shame.
One time I gave a talk and a lady, I did not realize this, but I found out at dinner time, you know, where you know how you are at conferences,
yes.
You sit down there. So, and a lady about my age, okay, a lady in her 60s, shared with me that she had run out of the room while I was talking because it stirred up the feelings she had as a child when her parents divorced, and it was still so painful for her that she couldn't stand to listen to it. So that tells me that it is that we are tapping a very powerful nerve by being sympathetic with these people, mm-hmm. you know, by saying we get it, but this was hurtful. Mm-hmm. So that's one whole class of things. The children of divorce, Molly, if we could recruit all the children of divorce and equip them with the message of the gospel and God's message about marriage, you know, mm-hmm. if we could equip all those people, we'd win in a heartbeat, you know.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
Other class of people, yeah, the other class of people that I are people who themselves did things wrong, made mistakes, committed adultery. Participated in the hookup culture, used contraception for a long period of time, and in some cases harmed their health or were unable to conceive later when they really wanted to. You know, there are many of these type of stories. And so I think it's fair to say that most people now, maybe not your listeners, because I know you have a lot of good Christian listeners.
You know, the brokenness that really the Western civilization, Western culture, promoted back in the 60s, and I guess it was sort of started off in the 50s, really started to bubble through a decade later towards the end of the 60s, and then blossomed into this evil plant in the 70s, and the repercussions are still, you know, the ripple effect is still very, very evident in our culture today. And I don't think, you know, you mentioned before the break that, you know, our listeners, the listeners to this program, and they are diverse and many, all of you out there, you know that all of us have been affected by divorce. So when you talk to the From the Median listeners, Jennifer, you are talking to these people that are broken. How are you dealing with this? How do we fix this? So give the people that are listening here who might have a cousin that's gone through this or an aunt or they themselves have gone through this. What are some of the key things we do to fix it?
Well, we offer a number of things on our website that are completely free. I mean, we have something that we call the 7 Steps to Sexual Healing. And you can work through those. We have a booklet that kind of outlines it and so on. But you don't have to buy the booklet. You can do it all online. You know, there are mm-hmm. worksheets you can work out and ways to kind of work yourself through the steps. And then we offer the opportunity to tell your story on the Tell Ruth the Truth blog. You know, we've got several blogs on the website. One of them is called Tell Ruth the Truth. And that is dedicated solely to victims and survivors of the sexual revolution mm-hmm. who write in anonymously and tell what it was like, you know. So recently we got a story from a man who has been contracepting for a long time, you know, who'd been part of contracepting couples and so on. And he talks about things that he did because he thought he could, you know, and how badly it turned out. And, you know, we have stories from people whose parents got divorced, you know, 30 years ago. We have stories from people who participated in the hookup culture and see the harms that were done to them and to their children. You know, people tell us all kinds of things. And I think, you know, not everybody who looks at the website is ready to do that. But I think the people who write for us in that way, mm-hmm. and as I say, it's completely anonymous. Nobody's going to know, you know, unless you tell them. they're doing a tremendous public service.
Exactly.
You're really helping your fellow citizens by saying, I did this and I was wrong, and not making any excuses for it, but just saying it. I did it and it was wrong. Mm-hmm. Because that helps people see, you know, we're all being led down the path of trying it again, as if nobody's ever tried it, you know,
yeah.
As if it's all just a whole open doorway of freedom opening up before us, and it's all going to be wonderful, you know.
Yeah.
These people are doing their fellow man a huge service by writing like that. So those are some of the free resources we offer people. We've got some pamphlets that talk about the harms that children have experienced from divorce. Those are very modest cost. You can buy those on our website. We've got a book called 101 Tips for Marrying the Right Person, and another book called 101 Tips for a Happier Marriage. And then we're also beginning now to do a program that we call Healing Family Breakdown, which is a half-day retreat, which you can learn about by writing to us at info@ruthinstitute.org about the Healing Family Breakdown Retreat, and you can about how you can bring it to your church, how you can bring it to your community. And, you know, a couple of us will come and put on that workshop, and you can have a lot of healing in your community through participating in that. And there are ongoing resources associated with that. So it's, you know, you have to give up a half day, you know, you have to give up your Saturday morning, basically. But you become part of our community, you become part of our network, and you receive regular encouraging emails and messages from us.
Mm-hmm.
So it'd be a very worthwhile thing for a lot of your listeners to consider bringing to their community, for sure.
If they wanted to do that, how do they contact you? You know, as you're talking, Jennifer, there are so many things that are coming to mind. I have young families all around me, and you know, members and the family, the extended family, etc. And they are in search, particularly the moms, are in search of. You know, they get together for Bible studies. They get together for whatever. You know, it may be a play group or something. How, if they decide that they want to do a small group discussion about, you know, the brokenness within maybe past brokenness or whatever, how do they contact you? What's the process to do that?
Just go to our website or type this in, info@ruthinstitute.org. You know, just the standard,
yeah.
You know, the standard contact us or email that every organization has, you know, info@ruthinstitute.org. Or go to the website. If you forget, just go to the website and there's a contact us button on there, and just say that you would like to, you know, bring the Healing Family Breakdown program to your community. If you're a Bible study, if you're a group that's already in existence, like the way you're describing, I would encourage those people to contact us, because so far we don't have anything specifically for that. But we do have material that could be easily adapted to it.
Sure.
And you know, Molly, I feel like I'm running around like a one-armed paper hanger all the time. You know, there are all these things that have to be done, and I feel like I'm the only person doing it. You know, it's pretty crazy.
Yeah.
But so when we get demand for something particular like that, that creates a, you know, an incentive for us to take the next step, because we have always intended to have a program that would be usable by existing groups, rather than, oh gosh, you got to assemble a new audience of people that have, you know, that are just for this occasion.
Exactly.
So there's a number of ways that groups of people can do this.
Exactly.
And I would recommend that you call us. But the first step, I would say the first step for a small group like that would be to go and get the 7 Steps to Sexual Peace booklet. Handbook type thing that we have on our website, and you know, just study that a little bit, and go back to the website and look at the different online tools that we offer to implement it, and I think people will be able to get a lot out of that.
Absolutely, Jennifer. How prevalent in your material is the Word of God? I mean, do you use biblical principles? Do you do Bible studies? Do you know, proving that this is the Word of God? I mean, what you do is actually the Word of God in action. So, is that part
That's
of
right.
the organization? I mean, is that part of what you do?
Well, we don't do that much that I would say is biblical or explicitly scriptural. As you say, I view myself as implementing Catholic Church teaching on marriage and family and human sexuality. But we're an interfaith organization. So people of all Christian denominations are attracted to what we're doing, and we very much want that to always be the case, you know.
Yes, exactly.
So we don't want to rely unnecessarily on papal documents, for example. Although, you know, we're quite consistent with the whole sweep of the magisterial
teachings, yeah,
including Familius Consortio and all of those and all of those kinds of things. So we don't bang people over the head with the Christian part, because other people do that. You know, other people will explain the Bible to you. What we do is I think we're doing applied natural law, quite honestly. We're an applied natural law organization, so that you can see that what the church has been teaching all along is supported by social science evidence, by neuroscience, by the biological sciences, by sound legal reasoning, you know, taking all of the different disciplines that have something to do with marriage, and you look at them and you really study them, you can see that the church's ancient teaching is far more sound than the gender ideology and the divorce ideology, the contraceptive ideology.
Exactly.
No question about it.
Absolutely. Yeah. I love people like Dr. Jennifer Roback Morse, who has really, although it's a very, very traditional and you know, time-honored issue that she deals with. She's really outside the box in today's life, where she deals with the breakup of the family. And Jennifer, I want to read a short intro to my next question, which is about your book and about your book that which is called 101 Tips for a Happier Marriage. And it comes right off of the RuthInstitute.org's website. So any of you who want to go there and read it, you can go right to their website. It says 101 Tips for a Happier Marriage is designed to help couples improve their relationships by making small changes in their habits and attitudes. Suggestions for everything from the most mundane aspects of marital life, housework, budgeting, weekend football, to the make or break components, forgiveness, kindness, prayer, help readers to love and appreciate their spouses anew. Tell us a little bit about this book, and why did you write it, and is it being well received, and how do people get the book? Lots of questions.
Well, you can get lots of questions there. You can easily get the book from RuthInstitute.org, our store, and we even have a distributor in Australia. So if you have any listeners down under, any of your podcast listeners or internet listeners from Australia, can get things from our affiliate that's down under there. So we have this book, and then also 101 Tips for Marrying the Right Person. So this book that you're talking about, 101 Tips for a Happier Marriage, this was really my first effort some years ago, Molly, to create something that was usable for the ordinary person. I thought to myself, you know, I have all this research about what makes for a happier marriage, why it's important, why it's worth working for, and so on. How do I, you know, nobody's going to read my research papers. How am I going to make this material accessible? And so years ago, before I even started the Ruth Institute, I created a pamphlet called 101 Tips for a Happier Marriage. It was a little pamphlet that would fit into an envelope, you know, and you could mail it to people. And then as we went along and as the Ruth Institute developed, my colleague, Betsy Karakas, was my newsletter editor. She still is my newsletter editor. She would take one tip a week and put it in our newsletter, and she would have a little commentary on each of the tips. And so that commentary often was quite comical, you know, because Betsy's a very funny person. And so there'd be elements of humor to it, or, you know, sort of down-to-earth practical things that she would add in to each tip. By the time we had done all 101 tips, we looked at it and said, hey, I wonder if this is a book.
Yes.
And so it turned out that it was a book, and it has done quite well with Ave Maria Press. And we know that it is being used in marriage prep programs and marriage enrichment programs and things like that. And so they were happy enough with how it went that they were delighted when we came up with the idea of another book called 101 Tips for Marrying the Right Person. And that book just came out. So and it seems to be already doing quite well. We're already quite happy with the response that we're getting to it.
Now, tell us, give us a little bit of an overview of some of the tips that you have used in this, because I think this is what I want this program to be able to do, is to say to people out there, Jennifer, that if, you know, we, all of us, every single one of us, don't think that if you're having some difficulties in your marriage, it's a very normal thing. You've got two entirely different people living together, and no matter how long you've been together, there are going to be times when things don't actually go right. So rather than giving up and saying, oh, this isn't working and blah, 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 you know, give us some of the things that you've said, you've found. Yeah.
Yes. Yes. Well, you know, there are whole parts of the book that have to do with why it's worth it, you know, explaining why it's worth the effort, you know. So there's, you know, there are tips about how much more retirement money you have if you stay married versus if you get divorced, you know. The statistics are quite startling. It's not just that you divide the retirement assets and so, you know, a divorced person has half of what a married person would have. It's worse than that. Assets get dissipated. So there's some of that kind of thing, you know, which is, you know, hang in there, it's worth it. But then there are also very practical things about what to do. I think my favorite set of tips was one called Winning is for Losers. And the theme of Winning is for Losers is that if you're the type of person who has to win every single argument that you have in your household, that is not a sign of strength.
Wow.
We think it's a sign
of
strength.
Let's say that again, because
it is,
I think,
not a sign of strength.
Yes.
If you have to win every argument, that is not a sign of strength. It's a sign of weakness.
Yes.
So the heading of all these tips is Winning is for Losers.
I love that. Because, you know, that's each and every one of us, Jennifer. That's all of us. We all tend to think that. Yeah. Yeah.
Oh, no kidding. Yeah. No kidding. And you know, look at our political life today.
Yeah.
People get their heels dug in around defending their particular position. And then, we very shortly after that lose our minds, you know, that we can't receive when somebody's trying to make a different point tell us what their point of view is, why it matters to them or whatever. We can't hear it. We can't hear it because we're so busy defending ourselves. Mm-hmm. That's not a position of strength at all.
Mm-hmm.
That's saying you're unsure of yourself. It's saying that you don't have the grace to be magnanimous to other people, you know. And so I think especially in our home lives, we've got to be able to be magnanimous towards our spouses and our children and our siblings, you know? I mean, for goodness sake, let them win once in a while. You know, I mean, I had a young friend. I literally had a young friend say to me, you know, Jenny, what should I do when I'm in a quarrel? You know, should I let my husband win an unimportant quarrel? I think this is how she put it. When should I let my husband prevail in an unimportant subject? And I said, you should always let your husband prevail on an unimportant subject. You know, if it's unimportant, who cares?
Yeah.
You know, literally,
yeah.
Who cares? You know?
Yeah, and oftentimes it's my, you know, I do it this way. What there used to be an Annie Get Your Gun type of, I remember broad show things where, and then one of them was called Annie Get Your Gun, and she used to say, you know, you do it your way and I do it my way. I mean, really and truly, at the end of the day, who cares?
That's right.
Yeah,
that's right.
Yeah.
And I can honestly say to you, Molly, you know, some of this stuff I've worked out over, you know, many years of married life.
Yeah.
And this is one of the first ones. I think I had a wise priest in confession one time say to me, you know, my husband wants me to do this and I just don't want to do it. And this priest just said, well, can you do this for him?
Oh,
and I'm
wow.
like,
oh.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, I guess I can. You
oh,
know?
Wow.
But I had had all this, you know, I had had all this feminist stuff saying, don't let him push you around, but be your own person and all that kind of stuff, you know?
Yeah, yeah.
And so I can honestly say, after many years of adopting this philosophy, I am not justified in arguing with my husband.
Mm-hmm.
In general, I am not justified in arguing with my husband, and I will therefore, you know, defer to him whenever possible. I can honestly tell you two things, Molly. Number one, he defers to me now far more than he ever did before.
Wow.
Because I'm not fighting with him all the time.
Yes.
You know, I mean, it took the edge off of it, right?
Yes.
So I can tell you for sure that's true. And the second thing I can tell you is in all of those years, I have had only one case where I really felt I had to insist on my way.
Mm-hmm.
And I've argued with, don't get me wrong, I've argued with him many times where I was not justified in arguing with him.
Mm-hmm.
Trust
mm-hmm.
me, I have. But I can think of really only one time where I had to go to the mat and I was truly justified in going to the mat. Everything else I could have let go. And that one thing was, are we going to let the kids make their first Holy Communion? And he was like, no, you're too religious, blah, 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 you know. Yeah. And this is obviously some years ago. But you know, I had to insist that I prevail on that one.
Yes.
And all the other things I've quarreled with him about, you know, really, I could have let go.
You know,
really,
Jennifer, you're so right, because I think there's so oftentimes as women, we are just the way we are, our natures, the way we are made and who we are. We are much more nurturing. I mean, I'm making a very blanket statement, and I stand by it, because I think that.
Yep, I stand by it too, Molly.
Yeah. I stand by that because, but in the nurturing, what you have just stated is so necessary, because we cannot nurture if we're always looking to fight and to win everything that we're doing. The nurturing is about oftentimes zipping the mouth, using the ears, using the eyes, you know, doing those types of things, rather than having a situation where, there, did it again. See, I'm stronger, you know. And that's what we've been taught to do since the 60s and 70s.
Right.
We've been told that if we don't do that, then we're little weaklings and all the rest of it. I've never felt like that. And I've always fought the feminist movement, because I've said, no, are you kidding me? I have got the task to bring up children in my home and to support my husband. And, you know, he does his piece, I do my piece. We are totally equal. So you're so right in that analogy of, you know, sometimes it's, you know, be okay to lose. What, goodness gracious, choose your battles, for goodness sake, you know? So.
That's right. And also, I don't want it to sound like this is only something that women need to do. I mean, men can benefit by graciously conceding. No question about it.
Yes.
And it makes you appear like a bigger man, right? It's only a small, petty person that has to win on every small, petty thing, you know?
Yes.
And we lose sight of that, I think, very much. You know, it's funny. You know, we just had this election. This interview is going to be broadcast like tonight or something,
yes,
right?
I yes, mean, absolutely.
Not,
yeah,
it's not going to go out like 2 weeks.
No. This is tonight. And if I rebroadcast it, folks, just know that oftentimes if we're rebroadcasting, we're telling you that it's a rebroadcast. So then you'll know it was right after the elections. So go right ahead, Jennifer.
I do think, you know, so much, there's at this particular moment, so much angst over President-elect Trump.
Yeah.
But I think it's worth saying that people rejected Hillary Clinton's way of being feminine.
Yes.
I think it was very important to her to be the first woman president, and so much of her life is geared towards that and so on. And I think many, many women reject that way of being female. We admire each other's achievements.
Mm-hmm.
We take nothing away from her legitimate achievements. But there was something very unattractive about her relentless pursuit of power and the way she appeared to treat other people. You know, there were so many reports of how she treated people.
Mm-hmm.
I think, and treated people badly,
mm-hmm.
you know,
her
underlings and things like that. You know, there was just, you know, maybe they were exaggerated, but there were so many.
Yeah,
there were so many
different places. Absolutely.
There has to be something to it. And I think that whether they're true or not, that was part of her persona. And I think many, many American women are rejecting that kind of feminism. And I think it's important for us as Catholic women to say that that's the case, you know, that we think that being a strong modern woman is something different
mm-hmm.
from what Hillary Clinton presented to us.
And very well
you know, there's
said.
A very broad umbrella of, you know, what we as Catholic women would consider good, strong, modern Catholic women. But it's not that. And I haven't heard anybody say that, either opposed or in favor of Mrs. Clinton. I haven't heard anybody really observe what her rejection means to the wider culture around gender issues.
Yes, absolutely. I am Molly Smith, your host. Dr. Jennifer Rerbach Morse from the Ruth Institute is our guest this evening. Again, I am really doing a big plug for her institute because I believe so much in what she's doing on the front lines of restoring the family and really restoring marriage to where it should be and the importance of marriage and putting back in the hipness. Let's put it that way. Jennifer, we both come from that age where it was hip to be sort of alternative. Now let's be hip again to be able to find the right spouse, to stay with that spouse, to raise your children together with that spouse, regardless of some of the issues that you may have to face. Get the help you need if you're going through those types of ups and downs in your marriage. But one of the things that I think is very important, and I love the fact that you've put out a little book called, and I think it's about six pocket-sized points for picking a partner. Firstly, number one, where do people, again, they get it on your website. So go to Dr. Jennifer Rerbach Morse's website, which is called Ruth Institute. But in a nutshell, what is in this? Why, you know, what should people be looking for when they're looking for a spouse?
Well, in this book, we take people kind of all the way through the process. You know, the first tips in the book are for people who are in the searching phase, you know, and they haven't found anybody particular, but we're trying to help people be grounded in having the right attitude as they go through that process. So one of the first tips is get a prayer life. Seriously, if you don't have a prayer life, get one now, because you're going to need that later.
Lovely. I love that. I love it. Yeah.
And then we go through, you know, in case you have somebody, here's a series of things to be looking for as you're dating, as you're meeting people. Once you have identified somebody that you think might be the right person, here are some more in-depth things to be asking yourself and to be talking about between you. And I think the most unique thing about the book, Molly, is that we go head on to the most challenging pastoral problems around marriage and marriage preparation, including cohabitation. Mm-hmm. Now, you know, and I know that the vast majority of people who come to get married, even in a Catholic church, mm-hmm. are already living together.
Sure.
And of those who aren't living together, a lot of them are already sexually active. So we put in here, in the form of tips, things to be looking for. If you're cohabiting, there are a series of problems that have been identified through social science research that may come up when you do get married. And so rather than regale people with statistics, we basically turn it into a tip and say, you know, you may want to be on the lookout for this or for that problem. You may want to have this conversation with your intended, you know. So we have a whole chapter on, you know, if you're cohabiting, these are things that you should be on the lookout mm-hmm. for. And then there's another chapter called Cohabiting, Are You? You know, mm-hmm. and should you? Right.
Yeah.
And the answer is no, you really shouldn't. And if you're not sure, here's what to ask yourself. Look at couples you know who are cohabiting and ask yourself this. Does the cohabiting experience mean the same thing to both of them?
Yes.
And you will find beyond any shadow of a doubt that they have very different pictures of what the cohabiting relationship means. Sometimes for the woman, it's a step towards marriage, and for the man, it's a perfectly acceptable long-term condition. Sometimes those roles are reversed, you know.
Yeah.
But the point is, it's not unusual for people to have slide into the cohabiting situation without really saying, this is what it means to me, this is what we're here to do, mm-hmm. And we're going to work together toward a common end. Mm-hmm. That's what's not present in the cohabiting relationship. So we take that head on, and I think a lot of marriage prep materials do not do that. You know, sometimes as Christian people, we're a little prissy about these things, you know, mm-hmm. we don't want to I don't know how to put it, but I think you know what I mean when I say that.
Mm-hmm. No, absolutely, absolutely.
That we don't want to be too direct about it, but we are quite direct about it.
Yes, exactly. And I think that's the issue. And I think it's for us also as.